From the lettering on the invitations to the placement of the flags and the order of the anthems, formal visits with United States presidents are dominated by protocol. But even the best-laid plans of presidential protocol can be undone by the missteps of the president's guests. You've RSVP'd your invitation to meet the president. Press releases have been issued and preparations are underway for your arrival. Then, at the last minute, you announce you're not coming. While 11th-hour cancellations are a breach of etiquette in any social circle, at the White House they are cardinal sins that can carry the risk of diplomatic failure. As reported in the Los Angeles Times, in July 1986, a few days before he was to arrive in Washington, Morocco's King Hassan II, chairman of the Arab League, declared he would not attend a previously announced meeting with President Ronald Reagan. The purpose of the visit was to discuss the fraught situation in the Middle East and his country's controversial treaty with Libya. Hassan's claim that the cancellation was ordered by his doctors was met with skepticism in Washington. He admitted later that the real reason for the postponement was his last-second decision to bypass Reagan and to conduct direct talks with Israel's prime minister, Shimon Peres, instead. According to the Washington Post, although Peres had urged Hassan to meet with Reagan, Hassan demurred, insisting he didn't want to appear to be, quote, under the umbrella of one superpower or another. Held a few days later, the two-man summit was deemed a failure, and improved relations between Israel and the Arab world remained a distant dream. Whether a Reagan meeting would have increased Hassan's diplomatic chances is unknown, but the abrupt cancellation did not help. Since the first visit by a foreign leader in 1874, the White House has seen its share of extravagant and odd presidential gifts. As chronicled by NPR, U.S. presidents have received everything from coats to daggers to wild animals. Queen Victoria gifted President Rutherford B. Hayes with a desk made from the British ship HMS Resolute, which remains in use in the Oval Office to this day.
The Resolute desk. You might recognize it from the famous photo of young JFK Jr. playing underneath while his father was working.
Wonderful.
To avoid the appearance of improper influence, the Foreign Gifts and Decorations Act dictates that presidential gifts from foreign leaders valued over a certain modest sum must be relinquished to the National Archives shortly after they have been received. This requirement proved problematic when, in 2005, Bulgaria's president gave George W. Bush a Bulgarian sheepdog puppy, like this one, being held by Vladimir Putin in 2010. The dog was wreaking havoc at the National Security Council when the director of the Presidential Materials Staff at the National Archives received a call to retrieve the gift as per regulations. The director balked. Because the dog couldn't be archived, the Bushes were allowed to purchase it for $430. The puppy was eventually rehomed with a family in Maryland. Since then, no animal, wild or domestic, has been gifted to the U.S. president. Occasionally, diplomatic interactions with U.S. presidents have been marred by poor translations. Diplomatic interpreters must not only be fluent in a particular foreign language, they must also be knowledgeable about the topic being discussed, be focused and impartial, and be adept at reading their speaker's body language and vocal inflections. According to Salon, during a 2010 visit to the Obama White House, the opening remarks of Mexico's president, Felipe Calderon, were nearly lost in a bad translation. As Calderon spoke about U.S.-Mexico relations, the inexperienced interpreter mangled the speech to the point of incomprehension.
This is the moment to overlook the fact of reproaching each other.
His work was so inept that the White House declined to post his translation in its official readout, instead offering the Spanish embassy's more accurate transcript. While the inartful translation didn't cause an international incident, it caught many in the White House off guard and proved an embarrassment to the Mexican administration. Not all presidential mistakes are made by foreigners and ordinary citizens. Even former presidents can violate White House norms and decorum. Former President Donald Trump's pointed absence from all of Joe Biden's inaugural events in 2021 was an expected snub and the first in recent history. But it was not the first. Three other ex-presidents chose the no-show routine before him. According to the White House history website, the Adamses, father John and son John Quincy, both failed to attend inaugurations for their successors. In 1801, John Adams slipped out of the White House just before his successor Thomas Jefferson's inauguration. Adams never explained his early morning departure, but some speculated that he left in order to avoid a confrontation with factions of Jefferson's opposing party. Following in his father's footsteps, John Quincy Adams exited the White House prior to his successor Andrew Jackson's 1829 inauguration. Although the two were both in Washington for weeks prior to the inauguration, neither made any effort to meet the other. The final breach of decorum occurred in 1869, when Andrew Johnson declined to attend the inauguration of Ulysses S. Grant. Animosity between the two was well documented, with each publicly calling the other a liar. According to the Washington Post, Grant refused to ride in the same carriage with Johnson, and Johnson retaliated by refusing his invitation to the inauguration. The tradition of serving wine at White House dinners is as old as the presidency. Of course, with wine comes inebriation, and with inebriation comes embarrassment. But perhaps the most notorious abuser of White House alcohol was Soviet President Boris Yeltsin. According to Politico, during his first visit with President Bill Clinton in 1994, a drunk Yeltsin stumbled out of Blair House, the presidential guest quarters, in the middle of the night, clad only in his underwear. Standing on Pennsylvania Avenue, he began yelling for pizza while trying to hail a cab. Secret Service agents stopped him, but the next night, he attempted to sneak out again. This time, he was nabbed by a security guard, who mistook him for a drunken intruder. Yeltsin also made dubious history during a 1995 meeting with Clinton in New York. There to discuss the Bosnian War, Yeltsin appeared with Clinton at a press conference after an afternoon of over-imbibing white wine. Visibly intoxicated, Yeltsin undiplomatically declared the U.S. press a disaster. Clinton responded with gales of laughter, interpreted by some as an attempt to cover up Yeltsin's drunkenness. As noted by Time, during a White House dinner in 2008, Italian Prime Minister Silvio Berlusconi overdid his praise for President George W. Bush when, on his way to give him a hug, he knocked over the lectern, breaking part of it. While still holding its remains, Berlusconi continued talking into the lectern microphones, telling Bush, quote, "This is what too much love can do." During his much-publicized 2018 Oval Office meeting with President Donald Trump, rapper Kanye West broke protocol and the internet when he let loose with an F-bomb, kept his baseball hat on, made a reference to male genitalia, and gave his host an awkward, rib-crushing embrace. White House dinners can be etiquette landmines for the uninitiated. At one state dinner, a guest of President Franklin Roosevelt unwittingly drank out of the so-called finger bowl used for rinsing your hands after eating finger foods, prompting Eleanor Roosevelt to drink out of hers in a show of social grace.
Wow, you know they're known for their lemon soup.
Sir, that's a finger bowl.
According to Vanity Fair, at a White House dinner celebrating Queen Elizabeth, former television talk show host Elizabeth Hasselbeck mistook her rose petal-infused finger bowl for dessert, but was saved from embarrassment by Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice. Bringing a weapon to a presidential meeting seems an obvious no-no. Someone should have told that to Elvis Presley. In December 1970, the legendary singer stopped by the White House for a visit with President Richard M. Nixon. In a spur-of-the-moment decision, Presley, an avid collector of guns and police badges, decided to fly to Washington, D.C. to secure a badge from the Federal Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs. Presley also happened to be a Nixon fan and figured the president could get him the coveted badge. To seal the deal, he wrote the president a note offering his help in the war against drugs in exchange for a federal agent's badge. As documented in White House memos, Presley arranged a meeting with the president through an intermediary. In striking contrast to the staid, gray-suited Nixon, Presley arrived at the White House dressed in a purple velvet suit and sporting a giant gold belt buckle and amber sunglasses. He was also carrying a World War II Colt 45, similar to this one, taken from his personal collection. All seemed to be going as hoped until Secret Service agents stopped Presley outside the Oval Office and confiscated the Colt. Apparently, not even the all-American Presley was to be trusted coming face-to-face with the president while holding a gun. In the end, though, Presley received his federal agent's badge, and Nixon got the Colt. For military personnel, disregarding presidential protocol is a decorum double threat, as the president is both a revered host as well as a boss. In his dealings with President Abraham Lincoln, General George McClellan earned a reputation as a serial protocol abuser. Despite the authority Lincoln had invested in him, McClellan showed disdain for his commander-in-chief, calling him a coward, and was often late for or absent from important meetings. In letters to his wife, McClellan also insulted Lincoln. In August 1861, after a White House dinner, McClellan wrote to his wife and described Lincoln as a well-meaning baboon. In a November 1861 letter, he wrote, "I went to the White House shortly after tea, where I found the original gorilla about as intelligent as ever." Soon after he had named McClellan General-in-Chief of the Union Army, Lincoln stopped by McClellan's home for a late-night meeting. Informed that the general was out, Lincoln decided to wait for his return, but when McClellan came back, he ignored his guest and retired to his bedroom. Although Lincoln refused to be offended, stating it was, quote, "better at this time not to be making points of etiquette and personal dignity," he fired McClellan a few months later. Gossiping about the president is not just a violation of decorum. It can lead to a PR nightmare if it happens to be recorded on a hot mic. During the 2019 NATO meeting at Buckingham Palace, as reported by CNN, Canada's Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, France's President Emmanuel Macron, and Great Britain's Prime Minister Boris Johnson were caught on tape poking fun at President Donald Trump. The world leaders were unaware their cocktail conversation was being picked up by a microphone. In the recording, Trudeau can be heard joking about Macron being delayed by a 40-minute press conference, an apparent reference to Macron and Trump's just-completed joint media appearance, which was dominated by the U.S. president's rambling commentary. According to CNBC, Trump's opening address at the meeting also far exceeded its scheduled 20-minute time slot. The tape quickly went viral, and when asked about the leader's hurtful remarks during a joint interview with Germany's leader Angela Merkel, Trump called Trudeau two-faced. A few days later, Saturday Night Live parodied the incident in its cold opening skit. The accidental recording proved comedy gold, but it also damaged Trump's already tenuous relations with the Allied leaders.
Are you crying?
No.
No matter how important your visit or welcoming your White House host may be, respecting the president's time is still an etiquette must. Abraham Lincoln was famous for his open-door visiting policy, which allowed ordinary citizens to show up at the White House to ask for a meeting. For hours, visitors would line up outside the residence, fill the rooms, and crowd the hallways, waiting their turn for an audience with Lincoln. As noted by the White House Historical Society, Lincoln believed that while these visits were time-consuming, there was no better use of his day than having, quote, "direct contact and atmosphere of the average of our whole people." Some visitors asked for pardons, others requested restitution for war losses, others delivered speeches, and some offered the president their policy ideas. Frederick Douglass discussed the plight of black soldiers during one such impromptu meeting with Lincoln. For the most part, Lincoln was a genial host and an attentive listener. Even when he was unable or unwilling to grant visitors their wishes, he gave each a fair hearing. However, even the patient Lincoln had his limits. If the petitioner droned on, he would bluntly urge them to get to the point. And if the visitor made the mistake of lingering too long, he might snap. Lincoln once told a soldier, "Now, my man, go away. I cannot attend to all these details." Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more Grunge videos about your favorite historical figures are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.